Blackstone Audio presents The Lost Girls of Camp Forevermore by Kim Fu. This book is read by Tavia Gilbert, Soneela Nankani, Sophie Amoss, Nicol Zanzarella, and Emily Wu Zeller. For JP. Camp Forevermore. The girls stood on the dock and sang the camp song, Camp Forevermore. They sang in voices at worst bored or dutiful, but more often thrilled, chests swelling with unity and conviction, that feeling of being part of something larger than themselves, their brash, off-key voices combined into one grand instrument. And I shall love my sisters forevermore. In 1994, the song had echoed out over the Pacific Ocean for 6 decades. They stood straight-backed and solemn-faced as soldiers in formation, even the ones who itched to squirm, to collapse into their natural, slumped posture, who were rolling their toes in their shoes and humming to themselves, squeezing their lips in their fingers to suppress a bubble of nervous laughter. Counselors dragged plastic bins of orange life jackets from one of the storehouses adjacent to the dock. The life jackets varied in size, and some had broken buckles and split seams. The girls picked through to find intact jackets that fit, the process both hurried and cautious, drawing attention to their newly divergent bodies. 10-year-old Siobhan Doherty snatched one and slid her arms through the holes. Would it reveal her to be too tall, too wide, too infantile? Anything other than the universal girl size implied by the unsorted bins? She fumbled to adjust the buckles and lengthen the straps, her fingers cold and stiff, until finally the jacket clicked shut. Satisfying clicks echoed up and down the dock. By some miracle, no one was left behind. 2 days earlier, Siobhan had stepped through the wooden gates of Camp Forevermore for the first time. The group of low log buildings in a man-made clearing, at the nexus of forest and sea, looked just the way it had in the brochure. Upper-middle-class girls, and, as of 1976, a small group of need-based essay contest winners, from up and down the northwest coast of North America, including both sides of the U.S.-Canada border, were sent to Forevermore. The name meant, like its religious and pseudo-Native American competitors, to project ancient knowledge. 9 to 11-year-old girls would leave home fretful and finicky and return as capable, knowledgeable outdoors women, remade in the wholesomeness of woods and sisterhood. The best of its kind, crowed the brochure. Siobhan wanted to be more like the heroines of the books she liked, about girl detectives and girl adventurers, tomboyish, scrappy, and resourceful, able to outsmart adults and survive without them, her body sun-brown and waif-like. She was instead a freckled, blue-eyed redhead, pale and dense as a block of shortening, who wasn't allowed to use the stove. The one time she'd been left alone at home after dark, she'd turned on all the lamps, the TV and the stereo, needing a protective shell of voices and light. Above all, she was looking forward to the kayaking trip, the central adventure of the first week. In small groups, the girls would kayak to a remote island and camp overnight. The brochure had stressed to parents that the overnight would build character and an appreciation of the outdoors within safe boundaries. But none of the pictures had adults in them. Just the campers, posing in their kayaks with their paddles triumphantly raised, carrying firewood and military-style duffel bags in their twiggy arms, holding hands and jumping into the ocean, bearing bold smiles of uneven teeth and no-nonsense braids and ponytails. These were girl pirates, girl spaceship captains, warrior princesses, the thrilling independent societies of children that had existed only in Siobhan's books. Even on that first clear afternoon, the dark earth between the gravel paths and the deep green of towering pine, fir, and spruce trees contained the memory of recent snow and rain. The ocean at the far end of the camp was the color of slate. Everything Siobhan was wearing was brand new, a black fleece she'd chosen for its silver, heart-shaped zipper pull, her first pair of hiking boots, even her underwear. She felt a thrilling, terrifying dissolution of self. She was far from her parents, her classmates, anyone who had ever known her. She was curious to find out who she
would be. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.